Penguin Random House Audio presents The Book of Joan, tales of mirth, mischief, and manipulation. This is the author, Melissa Rivers. For my mother, whom I think about every day, and for my father, who, as of this past September, is no longer resting in peace. Melissa, Helen Keller once said, "Life is a great adventure or it's nothing." Of course, she said it to a coffee table, but you still get the point. Joan Rivers. Borrowed time. I never thought I'd be sitting in a hospital making a decision about turning off a ventilator. I guess in my head, I knew it was a possibility, as we all know we may face that kind of decision for a loved one someday. I just didn't know I'd have to make it so unexpectedly. Just last night, my mother and I were on the phone laughing and joking about an old friend she'd run into. It was a typical checking in with each other kind of call. I had no way of knowing that it would be our last conversation. What I wanted was for my mother to sit up and say, "Wow, that was a nice nap. What time is hair and makeup?" What I needed was 5 minutes so I could tell her all the crazy, hilarious things that had gone on around her for the last week. We were probably the only two people in Mount Sinai who would have seen the humor in all this madness. But since I didn't get those last 5 minutes, in our family, we always laughed our way through the pain, so I decided to write a book that would have made her laugh. At least once a day, she used to turn to me and say, "Can you believe this shit?" And I'd say, "Yes, Mommy, I can." Mommy, I hope you're somewhere listening, and God knows editing this book. But the thing I hope most of all is that you're smiling. She works hard for the money. One of the questions I'm most often asked is, "Did your mother always work so hard?" I wish I had an answer. According to her cousin Alan, one of the few relatives she felt was worth speaking to or acknowledging, he once said, "Your mother was like this before you were born. She wanted to be sure she was one step ahead of everybody else. It used to make her grandmother crazy. We'd sit down to play a game of Monopoly, and by the time we were once around the board, she co-opted 3 hotels and was trying to foreclose on our cousin Charlotte's properties. I think this is one of the reasons I finally settled in Vermont. The family gatherings were way too intense for me." My mother was a comedian, actress, writer, producer, jewelry monger, tchotchke maker, spokesperson, hand model, celebrity apprentice winner, and self-appointed somewhat goodwill ambassador to 27 third world countries that were unaware they had a goodwill ambassador. It was kind of a power move on her part, not unlike the time she named herself block captain of her block in New York, which, by the way, had no block association. I think this was a nod to the Eisenhower years, which I never fully understood. Well, what it was many suburban neighborhoods had these block captains who were in charge of getting people into the local bomb shelters during nuclear attacks. The woman was ridiculous. James Brown may have been the hardest working man in show business, but I am pretty sure my mother was the hardest working woman. Even at 80 years old, she was on the go, from gig to gig, show to show, all the time. She was always working, always moving. She was like Sisyphus with jokes. Let me give you an example. A typical week for her last year was Monday. Start working on weekly episode of Fashion Police in the morning and during the day. Drive down to Philadelphia for the QVC show and work on her new book or a TV or a movie script in the car on the way down. Tuesday, more work on Fashion Police and meet with her various agents, business people, jewelry designers, etc., etc., etc. Nighttime performance at the West Bank Cafe in New York City. Wednesday, early morning flight to Los Angeles for Fashion Police meetings all day and all night. Thursday, arrive at E! Studios at 5 a.m. to prepare for Fashion Police taping at 8 a.m. Afterward, press obligations and business meetings. A quick dinner of Chinese food with Cooper before catching the red eye back to New York City. Friday, travel to whatever city she was appearing in that night and then give a 90-minute performance. Saturday, travel to whatever city she was appearing in that night, do another 90-minute show, then travel back to New York. Sunday. Not unlike for God, a day of rest. And by rest, I mean reading scripts, writing a book, doing the Sunday New York Times crossword puzzle in ink. Let me just stop right here for a second and tell you something. She was a terrible speller. But no matter how many spaces were allowed, she'd make those letters fit. No puzzle went unfinished. When I would point out that there was a mistake, she'd say, "Don't bother me with the details. It works for me." I actually put a book of crossword puzzles, a pair of glasses, and her favorite pens in her casket. Somewhere in heaven, there's a small blonde woman misspelling a four-letter word for Asian housemaid. And once that was done, maybe, just maybe, she would find time to catch a matinee of a Broadway show with her best friend, Margie Stern, and then immediately afterward call her agent to find out if she could take over the lead in whatever show she had just seen. I swear, I once overheard her screaming at her agent, "I'd be a fabulous Willie Loman." And that was a light week. She still found plenty of quality and quantity time to criticize me. Just writing that tires me out. I remember a conversation we had after one of our very long Thursdays. We'd shot an episode of Fashion Police and then taped scenes for Joan and Melissa, Joan Knows Best, and that night we did four interviews for In Bed with Joan. At the end of the night, after the camera crew and production team had finally left, I went downstairs to her bedroom. She was laying in bed in her bathrobe, and I started telling her that she needed to slow down. I told her that it wasn't healthy, physically, mentally, or emotionally, especially at her age, to keep working these hours. I told her that I was worried about her and that Cooper was worried about her too. I was pouring my heart out thinking, oh my God, I'm getting somewhere, as she hadn't interrupted me. I looked over and saw that her eyes were shut. I thought she had fallen asleep and hadn't heard a word I'd said, so I nudged her and said, "Mom?" She shushed me and said, "Melissa, please, I'm practicing visualization techniques and I'm seeing myself as the face of Depends." Oh, and for those of you that are wondering, the correct answer for Asian housemaid is Amma, A-M-A-H. Somewhere in heaven, she's probably trying to shove in cash under table. The need to succeed. I don't know or pretend to know what happens to us after we die. I mean, nobody really does except the dead, and they're not talking. At least not to me, but I have AT&T. I mean, I can barely get living people on the phone. I also don't know if there's a heaven or a hell, even though I've been to Winnipeg in the winter, or an afterlife. But what I do know is that if there is an afterlife, my mother is coming back as a pack animal. It's the only other one of God's creatures that was born and raised to work as hard as she did. The thing is, she never thought of it as work because once she knew what she wanted to do, there was no stopping her. I think both nature and nurture had a role to play in my mother's tireless and never-ending work ethic. Her parents were both Russian immigrants who were uprooted from their countries and came to the United States with nothing. I believe the immigrant mentality of working hard to get ahead was taught to my mother and her sister, my Aunt Barbara, by their parents. So when my mother became a parent, there was no question she was going to be a working mother. And she became one long before it was fashionable or, as times have changed, necessary. Although, truth be told, she considered work a necessity, like water, air, food, and bespoke living room furniture. She didn't have to get a job. My father always made a good salary, and we would have been more than comfortable on his income. So, during my childhood, my mother's drive was not all about money, although we certainly lived well, and it also wasn't about fame. On one of her last national televised interviews, it was on the Tavis Smiley Show on July 13 and 14, 2014. Tavis asked her why she worked so hard at comedy, and she said it wasn't a choice. She told him that comedy was her calling. She said that's why comics are here. We're put on earth to make people laugh. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. I mean, I didn't take philosophy, theology, or astronomy in college. But I believe she thought it was true, which would explain why she took a very hard-earned and expensive degree from Barnard College in English literature and put it on the shelf in order to tell jokes to drunks at Shriners conventions. To be totally honest, she didn't go into comedy right away. After she graduated, she tried to do the expected thing and got a job working at the world-famous Bond Clothes in Manhattan. Her work ethic was in evidence even then, as she worked a million hours a week doing everything and anything she was asked. Her diligence eventually...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.